You birds are lucky I'm the good guy. If I weren't, I'd make sure you jerks couldn't fly out of here before this heap comes crashing down. I'd like to stay and make stuffing out of you turkeys, but I need to get back to make sure my friends and family are all okay. If anyone isn't okay, then you'd better hope you can run faster than me. As a present for his 17th birthday, the Freedom Fighters gift Sonic with a reconstructed version of the clubhouse they all used to play in as kids. The same secret base from all the way back in issue 1, a return to simpler times. Just as well, with Robotnik knowing their location and after multiple attacks on their friends and families, this base can serve as a new target for the Doctor Strikes, to better protect those who often got caught in the crossfire. And so of course, back-to-back birthday presents appear at Sonic's doorstep. In fact, Dr. Eggman is sending it right now! Happy birthday, Sonic! Meanwhile, we have the alternate reality hedgehog himself celebrating his birthday, Evil Sonic, who gifts himself with a power boost from the Master Emerald and a deliciously evil new name as Scourge. But that's not all, as Scourge has one more birthday wish he's been dying to get. Another chance to beat up Sonic. They go at it, and Scourge is having a ball, proving his new strength is more than enough for a Sonic or a Shadow, up until the two decide to work together. And even then, he's so prideful he's got a flex while going down, and eventually escaping. Throughout it all, you can tell just how much fun Sonic's having. The moment his birthday is blown up, he looks surprised, but also a little excited too, smiling all the way, to the point he can't even contain himself at the sheer absurdity of it all. While everyone thinks this party must have been a bust, Sonic assures them it was a great birthday. Not just because he had fun, but most importantly because his family and friends were safe at the end of the day. The base worked like a charm, and he knows he and his friends can survive way worse. After all, they're the Freedom Fighters, and if he has them, he knows he can do anything. It's one of the things that makes the blue blur so fun. Unlike Scourge, Sonic is having a blast or being confident, even when things are stacked against him or he's on the back foot. Like during a later encounter where Scourge tries to hit Sonic with some Joker nonsense about how the reason Sonic hates him is because he knows he could be just like him. But Sonic dismisses this out of hand and says the real reason is because he knows Scourge could be a good hero. You know, if he wasn't such a self-centered loser with zero decency. Basically, Sonic is just really cool. Thanks, but the windows were cleaned yesterday. Come back next week, okay?
This is a sacred place. You cannot desecrate it with violence. I just said,
we're not fighting though. We're just having a friendly conversation, right?
There's an infectious charisma to Sonic that I just can't look away from. Like this scene where Sonic is having an argument with Bunny over a pretty serious situation, with both giving their best in combat. Yet, throughout it all, Sonic is playing with Bunny's hat, gently placing it back on her head with this warm smile, providing this extra layer that lets you know he's not really upset with her, which leads to them coming to an agreement. It's Sonic getting down to business and taking hit after hit to help a brainwashed rival, coming up with a plan right on the spot. It's Sonic using his wit to weasel his way through a class system based around the way you dress, and with full confidence claiming he's wearing his interpreter gloves and negotiator shoes to strike a bargain. Every moment with Sonic just draws me in, and that's in huge part thanks to the artwork, especially from Tracy Yardley, who embodies the looseness of the Adventure Era designs with a variance of thickness to the line art that just makes it so striking to look at. Sonic can't just stand normally, each pose has to be big, each emotion is expressed to an extreme. Sonic kicks ass with so much style, his toothy grin so tight his teeth look like they could shatter. Sometimes there's even this cinematic flair to how Sonic is portrayed.
Quips and fists cannot overcome my magic, Quickster.
Yeah, I know. Yo, Elias, I could use a bit of a magical edge if you get what I mean. If you think you can use it. You're the most experienced with this monster, so the crown defers to you to handle the intruder.
You cannot stand in the way of justice, Quickster.
Come here, ugly. Your beard could use a trim. From panels cutting to his determined assault during a villainous monologue, to lightning shattering the sky to reveal our hero's last-minute return, to the sense of scale of the mechs, armies, and freaking dragons he faces, followed by a split second of carnage, a cocky escape, or deadly determination. How many's here, Queenie? 100? Max?
My, the weak grow overconfident when cornered. I've driven you from my city once already and attacked yours without consequence. You're doomed, little hedgehog.
Yeah. Tails, get the doc back to Pneumo Metropolis.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
I've got this.
When he's about to fight the Egg Phoenix, he's so excited because defeating it involves using himself as bait by being chucked into the stratosphere, officially dubbing it as his most favorite plan ever. You point a gun in Sonic's face to threaten him, and he'll just put his finger in the barrel and keep talking crap. He's so cool. Sonic goes up against so many odds in the comic, and some of them he genuinely can't muscle his way through. Yet, you wouldn't know it by the way he acts. You knock him down, and he just gets up to flirt with his girlfriend, talk crap from the bleachers, and craft a comedy bit just to mess with his friend while he's the one retreating from an army. At one point, he gets shot and tossed into a bottomless pit, and yet both hero and villain alike, when told this, are just like, "Oh cool, what happened after that?" My man's fighting a demigod of ultimate power over here, a fight he legitimately cannot win, and yet Sonic is just straight up bullying this man. Now let's squish this inner germ. Whoa, hey! Are you quite finished? Actually, Jumping Jack, Enter Tube, Flapjack, Interstate, Enter Jack in the Box, and come to think of it, Enter Jack sounds like some kind of sports drink. Now I'm finished. The golden guy at the end of Sonic's Tango of Taunts, by the way, is Enerjack, aka a corrupted Knuckles, trapped under a spell that has twisted his good intentions into unflinching and uncaring conviction. However, despite everyone seeing Knuckles as a threat that needs to be dealt with either carefully or violently, Sonic's there to say, wrong answers, and gleefully shatters the one device that could destroy Enerjack. Sonic will save his buddy his way, with a different, more nostalgic approach.
Stop! What are you doing?
Something Scourge tried not too long ago. Don't worry, Knuckles, I'll neutralize Phanitivus's voodoo the same way I undid Perfect Chaos. I'm going to beat the evil out of you. That's right, Sonic is gonna save his friend by kicking the crap out of him with positive energy, combined with taunts and insults designed to bring out the real Rad Red. The Knuckles who says, "It's crunch time," or thinks the best way to deal with a burrowing creature is to bury them, the doofus. And as the fight comes to a close through the combination of Sonic's efforts and a father finally willing to do something right for his son instead of for the world, Knuckles is saved, as we get what is probably my favorite use of Super Sonic, to be there to catch his friend and bring him gently home. There's a kindness to Sonic that hits so hard when contrasted with his usual cocky personality. A Sonic who, when it looks like the bad guys have got away, will remind his friends the reason they flee from our heroes in the first place. A Sonic who taunts his rival and loves to flex, but who thinks about him when he's not around hoping he's doing okay, and won't let them leave him again. A Sonic who, when he sees that things have been really bad for his friend, reminds her of all the good she accomplished for the world and the people she cares for, taking her hand as the two walk into the sunset and head for home. Sonic really loves his friends. He loves to tease them, he loves to spend time with them, and he loves to make them feel good. He'll even wingman for you. But the coolest part of Sonic to me is that he admires his friends. When Sonic straight up loses to the Egg Beater, loses to Eggman, he does falter at first, ends up thinking he needs to save the day on his own to protect the friends he has left. But when the time comes for the rematch, Sonic takes a step back from the action, and reinforces what he's always believed. For all your smarts, Doc, you totally miscalculated us. Did you really think we'd just roll over and give up? Did you think I was the only hero on Mobius? I can handle just about anything you can dish out. But on the rare occasion I can't, my friends always can. Face it, Eggman, you don't have a leg to stand on.
Ah, shut up!
You said this was all a game to you. We've chosen to continue. Game on, Robotnik! I love that a heroic Sonic speech always doubles as a condescending insult towards the bad guys for even daring to stand up to him or his friends. Which, speaking of, eventually, Sonic goes up against Scourge again. After taking Sonic's words that the two could be similar in a different direction than Sonic intended, Scourge took over his planet and dubbed himself King. Not content to simply exist as Sonic's eviler extreme, he wanted his own feats and titles, and by the end, it seems like he may succeed in ridding himself of his goody-two-shoes reminder. However, Sonic knows just the thing that'll get under any Sonic skin, as he lets Scourge know that at least he can die happy since he never had to resort to a super form to beat him before, tricking the purple demon into depowering himself for the sake of his ego, and therefore receiving the brunt of the negative effects of being an anti-Super Sonic. But Scourge, he just won't accept he's been beat. I mean, he conquered his own world. He's king. He's... You're a bully, and that's it. You take the easy, nasty way out and get the quick reward. Big whoop. I do things the right way. I help others to make something bigger and better than just me. The good guys always win in the long run, and there isn't anybody who can run longer or better than I can. This last line is my favorite part. It ties into what gives Archie Sonic this interesting extra layer. His ego. The comic fully embraces this dichotomy. As the Archie Sonic Encyclopedia book states, Sonic has always been at odds with his nature, arrogant on the one hand, but unwavering in his heroism on the other. Basically, it's not enough to beat Scourge, to uphold and express the values of doing good. Sonic needs to make sure he knows who's better, to throw him into the mud where he belongs. He's annoyed that Scourge just won't give up, that he just keeps talking when he's been beat, that you're nothing is the final straw. And it's just really interesting to see Sonic's response be both righteous indignation and personal catharsis. Going back to that scene of Sonic telling Scourge all the good parts of himself that his evil counterpart is lacking, well, I mean, just look at him. My man is feeling good about himself here. And why shouldn't he? After all, he's the Hero of Mobius, a title that nearly every issue in this era bestows upon him. Someone who sacrificed himself to save the planet from destruction and effectively returned from the dead as far as the public is concerned. They made a statue for him, for crying out loud. He's a celebrity, and he's embraced the hype. I mean, look at him. He's the likable Sonic. Lovable, even. He's too good looking to be pummeled. I actually got us reservations at Crème de la Crème. You did? Reservation for two under Sonic? I'm sorry, sir, I don't. Sonic, Hero of Mobius, fought Robotnik with the princess right here? Ah, of course, right this way. Sonic has done this song and dance for over a literal decade in-universe, and he is confident that he knows what to do and that he can do it. Basically, he has in some small way a hero complex. His identity is rooted in his ability to save the day, and if that falters too much, well...
Egad! Snively! Track the hedgehog via the egg spy satellites! Where did he go? Limit? I've got your limit right here! Watch out, sir!
Oh, my gears and starters.
How's that for my limit, Eggman? It's just fine, Sonic. Although I am a little upset that you dented the shield. After this, well, Sonic is humiliated. He's shaking in fear by the end. He's crying.
Yet when Tails comes to rescue him, the expression he has is pretty genius. One half a confident smile, and the other a grimace. The fight got to Sonic. He returns home and coldly recounts the facts to his shaken and concerned friends as he marches forward. He'll get their families and friends back, so don't you worry. Of course, he's concerned for his friends' safety. He doesn't want them to also get hurt, but his words and expressions give a extra perspective. Once again, we're seeing that dichotomy of Sonic's heroism and his ego, and it's just so fascinating to watch in action. Heck, on the way to fight Eggman, he's pouting in the car after his friend has to yell at him to stop for a second and let them help. When they arrive, he bursts in with a confident one-liner, only to switch once again as he realizes the urgency of the situation and says, "No, I can't be too late again." He so desperately needs to fulfill his role of being the Hero of Mobius. In fact, this whole scene is the perfect example of how real Archie Sonic feels to me. His anger and confidence when confronting Eggman melts away when Sally asks how he's holding up, immediately followed by Sonic putting on his hero face again when the plan is put into motion, dropping it again so that he can have a moment with Tails, only to put that on hold so that he can revel in what's about to happen. Which leads to the more comedic side of Sonic's ego as they're running away from Eggman, and they're cornered. Sally asks Sonic if he thinks he could save them, and he just says, "Sure, but not this time." As Sally's panicking and freaking out, Sonic never falters, allowing her to believe in her last moments that he simply let her get captured for the sake of his pride. Thankfully, letting Eggman zap them all was in fact part of the plan, but Sonic, you couldn't spare a word of comfort because you were afraid Eggman would figure out the plan you can't tell Sally, but that you are openly explaining to her exists? Yeah, okay, buddy, I see you, you smug hog. That petty revenge tastes pretty good, huh? A moment like this would feel pretty cruel if it wasn't so freaking funny, and if things didn't work out. But of course they do. He's Sonic. It's because of this arrogance that Sonic's cheeky impatience we all know and love is sometimes expressed differently. Sonic is about taking action, and if you know your place, you won't stand in his way when he knows it's time to move. Sonic has this bite to him. He doesn't just mock the villains he fights, he looks down on them, belittles them, and he will not stand for anyone's nonsense. What's the deal? You wouldn't be giving me such a hard time if it was Eggman standing here. Julian is my enemy as well. One, nobody calls him that anymore. Get with the times. Two, I wasn't talking to you. Three, your hissy, raspy voice makes my skin crawl, so shut it! He's not just this way with villains, either. You aren't doing your job, Sonic the Zone Cop? You think it's a necessary evil that me and my friends have to deal with an alternate reality Robotnik? Wrong answer. And don't you walk away from me! The citizens are turning on my friend? They think she's a threat? Huh, maybe Eggman should come back. See how fast these ingrates go from, "Wah, she's evil," to, "Oh, save us, Nicole, with your force fields." Really, sometimes Sonic is just being a dick. Like the way he talks down to Monkey Kong, that one time he openly just says he doesn't take Amy's word that seriously. Sonic messing with Antoine for accidentally implying that Sonic isn't fast, which is so petty, I love it. Or when he just casually says things that make you go, "I know Tails had a thing for Fiona, but I thought we dealt with that. If she keeps this up, though, he can have her." Sonic, that's your girlfriend! Yet, despite it all, moments like these actually make me like Sonic more. To one minute be laughing my butt off at the insane verbal beatdowns he gives villains, to laughing my butt off at the few moments where that energy gets redirected at his friends, who I know he cares about so much. And make no mistake, those moments are few, and they're almost always followed by Sonic doing something positive right after that lets you know he's not that serious. But that general arrogant vibe from Sonic is always there. His default state is sass. It just simply manifests in a variety of contexts and levels of appropriateness, meaning you really never know just what's going to come out of his mouth, culminating in one of my favorite pieces of Sonic characterization. Then what about Tails? Can you stand him knowing you helped keep his father in jail? I know you're his real family, but he grew up with me. Heck, the kid worships me. He'll get over it. Alright, let's do this. Tails' first line in all of Archie is, "Sonic, my hero," as he excitedly shows off how he's been practicing to run just like him. More than most interpretations of the character, Tails is definitively presented as a child. This little kid who we watch make mistake after, well, cringy mistake, but who we also see develop and mature over the in-universe years the comic takes place in. A Tails who, at this point, has grown into his own hero, even if he's still a young boy. Throughout it all, Sonic is there, and Sonic cares a lot about Tails. His little brother who he will defend to the death and will not allow to be mistreated. But Sonic, for all his bravado and confidence that we know and love from him, is still capable of being hurt pretty badly and letting those things get to him. After a very awful and very public breakup with Sally, Sonic wound up with Fiona Fox. At first stepping in to keep Tails from getting rejected from asking her out, that time together eventually led to Sonic and Fiona dating, which for Sonic was mostly just about filling in the void left by Sally, with said relationship ending in another messy breakup. Until said breakup, however, Sonic dated Fiona all while knowing just how much his emotionally immature little bro liked this girl, never once seeing how he was doing after Tails openly screamed he hated Sonic for this, as he then continued to bring Fiona around Tails and talk about her casually without seeming too concerned about how this could make him feel. Because Sonic fully believes that Tails just got over his crush after he started dating Fiona and moved on from his little tantrum. After all, Tails looks up to Sonic. He wouldn't be holding a grudge against his big brother. And to Tails' credit, he seemed to realize that Sonic didn't intentionally mean to hurt him, even stating during this period that he knows that of all people, he can trust Sonic. Despite clearly having some unresolved emotions, these two are brothers, and so the two kept their close connection, even amidst the unspoken red fox in the room. Eventually, however, Tails is reunited with his family, something Sonic is so happy to give back to him. But Tails' dad makes some pretty powerful enemies through his call for changes to the kingdom and its monarchy, and so he eventually is thrown in prison. Tails is obviously upset, but it's Sonic's reaction that is really interesting. He belittles Tails' dad right in front of him, looking incredibly disappointed. After Tails leaves, Sonic is confused when he's called out. He doesn't care if that's Tails' father, because said father shouldn't have put himself in that position in the first place since it's hurting Tails, who he cares about, who he's offended for. Not to mention Sonic's, you know, friends with the king, so he's got multiple grievances here with Tails' dad, and ultimately brushes off any concerns from his friends about his and Tails' relationship by reaffirming that they're brothers and that there's nothing to worry about. Which, of course, leads us back here. Sonic's words are bad. They are so dismissive. Yet Sonic, in his arrogance, fully believes he's right and that he is more important to Tails than any long-lost mom or dad could be, because he's based his view of Tails on that little kid who needs his big brother to look out for him, and views him as an infallible hero. And at this point, Tails has had enough. Now all that trust he once had in Sonic is called into question. Does Sonic tease me because he's mocking me? Was I not allowed to go on missions when I was younger because Sonic looked down on me? Is the reason that Sonic went out with Fiona, that he never made any deal out of it, because he doesn't care how I feel? For Tails, it's not about whether or not his crush was meaningless or not. It's that Sonic inherently treated those feelings as so that really hurt him, now reaching a crescendo when combined with his dad, which confirmed Tails' fear that Sonic, the great Sonic the Hedgehog, doesn't care, culminating in the line, I thought you were my friend. I thought you were my brother. But everything I care about, you take away from me. And this is what makes this conflict so compelling to me. How Sonic's ego, that arrogant part of himself that is usually reserved for how he treats villains, that is usually fun, when combined with his sense of importance in Tails' life, can lead him to overstepping this hard. With Tails being genuinely hurt by the fact that Sonic has so casually brushed off his feelings, that actually all this time he's been looking down on Tails, without ever even noticing that he's been doing it, or when he does, outright dismissing it as just a tantrum. It's at this point that Sonic definitively realizes, oh, gotcha, I'm the asshole here, and tells Tails that if he truly believes all that, then to go to town on him. And I love that he means this, that to him, if Tails really feels that Sonic has hurt him that bad, then he will gladly take a beating for it. Of course, this gets to Tails, and Sonic breaks down his actions to him, how in his loneliness he justified to himself that being with Fiona would help Tails move on, even though really it was just to satisfy himself in the moment. Getting to the core of that flaw and probably the most introspective thing I've ever heard from Sonic. Fiona was there. I went with it like I do everything else. I just do. In this moment, we get what feels like a different perspective of the line, I'm just living by my own feelings. From Sonic's character theme, it doesn't matter. As we've talked about, Sonic just lives in the moment, letting his emotions and whims guide his speech and actions. And that can hurt people, including his little brother. Sonic apologizes, allowing for zero excuses for his actions, even if his intentions weren't cruel. Because as he says, he may not have meant to hurt Tails, but that doesn't change the fact that he did. This scene is full of little details I love, like how Sonic just starts crying mid-explanation, which feels incredibly real, that he's welling up just from the weight of the situation. I love that Sonic, after his apology, breaks the ice by giving Tails a noogie, but ends their conversation by shaking his hand. Even Tails' over-the-top expressions, him randomly swinging at Sonic, just gets me. To me, this doesn't feel like watching a little kid throw a tantrum, as Sonic once saw it. It feels like watching a little kid who feels genuinely confused and betrayed. It feels vulnerable, and therefore messy. And in general, as an older brother myself, this story always hits on a different level for me, as I always end up vicariously feeling Sonic's same emotions of guilt. The scene just gets me, man, and always makes me smile seeing it end on such a happy note. This story is definitely one of the most infamous in the comic, and to be honest, I don't actually like that it was introduced in the first place, since it was clearly set up to be yet another shallow romance plot that the comic loved doing at the time, which when combined with the I hate you scene, and these horribly over-the-top covers that also prime you to hate Sonic, it gives this idea such an unpleasant foundation. There's a lot of baggage here, but ultimately, seeing that shallow setup be recontextualized by a new creative team as a way to explore Sonic's character, it makes me really glad it happened. By the end, it allowed for Sonic to have a very vulnerable and ultimately hateable moment that will always be a part of him, that his arrogance can get that out of line, only to have him get punched for it and brought to a better understanding of his own flaws and short-sightedness. And that's incredibly compelling to me, and I think only makes the comic better in the long run because going forward, Sonic and Tails now have a stronger foundation to contextualize their bond. Tails still has his admiration for Sonic, and we keep their older-younger brother dynamic, but now these interactions have this added weight that makes them feel more like equals. It's actually what I like about the scene where Tails, pretty harshly, calls Sonic out for trying to rescue everyone on his own after getting defeated by Eggman. Of course, the tension of Sonic thinking he knows better is what causes Tails to speak so bluntly, he might have a bit of an aversion to that, but the intentions clearly stem from just not wanting Sonic to die because of his arrogance, let alone their friends and families. He cares about him, and it's just so cool to see Tails of all people hold Sonic accountable. And after their fight, tense moments like these end with not a brawl or a standstill, but instead Sonic trusting in Tails' judgment, even if he clearly rather do things his own way. But in general for the comic, I just love that I get to follow a Sonic that can sometimes be seriously affected by his emotions and needs support to get through it. Maybe it's via a punch to the face for being a jerk, but other times it's Sonic needing a friendly dig from Knuckles when he's visiting the gravesite of an old friend, getting caught up in the idea that things could get worse. Sometimes it's Sally holding Sonic's hand and telling him that whatever comes next, it'll be an adventure of its own, allowing him to smile after a hard battle. Which, speaking of, yeah, that supposed final battle with Eggman didn't exactly go how Sonic planned. All the insults and beatdowns over the years finally got to the Doctor, and Sonic has to watch as his oldest foe loses his mind right in front of him. He beat him so bad he made the man cry. Talk about cracking the Eggman wide open, sheesh. Hey, it's kinda like what Eggman did to Sonic, where he had the upper hand and used his overwhelming confidence confidence and power to break his spirit. And look at that, Sonic and his friends are doing the same here, except Eggman breaks, where Sonic doesn't give up thanks to his friends, thus contrasting the hero and villain. Parallels are cool, this comic is really good! Sonic feels pretty bad about this, and honestly, he feels bad that he feels bad. This is Eggman for crying out loud, and everyone but him is pretty content with the Doc remaining as an insane roly-poly man. Yet, in the end, Tails is the one who's there for Sonic to offer him validation for his feelings and advice on what to do moving forward. While Tails doesn't feel any sympathy for Eggman, he understands that they don't have to be cruel to him, and maybe how Sonic could feel like he went too far, even if accidentally, allowing Sonic to feel a little better by bringing the Doctor safely to prison and out of his deranged nephew's hands, leading to what I think is another wonderful moment for Sonic's characterization, as Sonic is questioned as to how he could show mercy to someone so evil, who's done so much to hurt him and those he loves. Sonic shrugs and says, "I don't know. I guess I just move too fast to feel all vengeful and stuff. I just do what's right at the time." Once again, Sonic just lives by how he feels. Just a feeling of sympathy for a man he watched break right in front of him. A Sonic who lives in the moment. And whether that makes him a Zen master or a fool, it's definitely what makes Sonic, Sonic. I'm going ahead. Nicole, can you track where his voice was coming from? That's far enough. Sally? Sal? You know, I was gonna start this section by talking about how I'm not really a shipper or anything, but then I realized I owned a copy of this rare Spaz artwork of Sonic and Sally's wedding, and that I have it framed in a comic sleeve, and so yeah, that would have been a frickin' lie. I adore Sonic and Sally's relationship. Despite spending more time as exes than an actual couple, these two have this wonderful chemistry that permeates each of their scenes. Both are headstrong and sassy, which leads to them trying to one-up or mess with each other for their own pleasure, sometimes even unintentionally, and it's always so much fun to watch. With how dominant Sonic is in almost every other social interaction he's in, it makes Sally's no-nonsense responses so charming, because she exudes her confidence in the same way Sonic does, with a snarky pose and a smile. And that unbothered energy, I think, is why Sonic gets so much joy from pushing the right buttons or catching her off guard. It's this cute, "I gotcha, didn't I?" energy. Similarly, Sonic is this grand hero who does all these amazing feats, and yet he so clearly respects and appreciates Sally's intellect and how much she takes on as a princess. How she's able to save the day in ways he can't, or fights battles through means that he would, quite frankly, be bored by. Sally is the planner, and Sonic always refers back to her because, one, she's proven herself capable, but two, because it allows Sonic to have all the fun with none of the hassle. He appreciates that she sits around and thinks so that he doesn't have to stop moving. While it's a ridiculous and, frankly, dark way of putting their relationship, Eggman was right when he says that Sonic is the weapon of mass destruction that Sally aims. In other words, the will and the way. But I like Eggman's version better because it just makes both feel even more like badasses. I love it. But there's another side to their dynamic too. Sally has many stressors placed upon her over the course of the comic, and she is not able to handle them alone, no matter how much she tries to bear it all. And so it's awesome how when these situations arise, Sonic doesn't baby her. In fact, it's in these situations and conversations that Sonic needs his overwhelming confidence to be able to compete with Sally the most. And you make it sound like we've already lost. Did you forget we escaped? More importantly, that I escaped? We've come back from way worse than this, Sal. So stop wallowing in self-pity and start coming up with a plan. I am not wallowing in self. You're right, Sonic. Thank you. That's what I'm here for, Sal. These two grew up together, and that history sells the weight they give to each other's words. Sonic knows what Sally is capable of, and refuses to let her act in any way that's less than what he knows her to be. Heck, he won't even let her have a one-liner without making sure she knows it was a handout to make her feel better. Like, shut up, Sonic, I love you. Are you sure you want me to do this? I don't want to get slapped around again. Oh, shut up and kiss me for luck. These two! But of course, none of this cockiness comes at the cost of Sonic letting Sally know how much he cares about her, and being willing to get serious in the moments she needs it the most. We Sonic and Sally shippers are spoiled, man, I tell ya. They get married, have kids, and whole stories dedicated to showing their domestic life in the future. Bro, look at Sonic's daughter. She thinks her dad is so cool. And you know what? She's cool too. Sonic and his kids fight perfect chaos together. Sonic gets to be a Chad father and husband. And Sally's having a great old time. I love it. Then there's the Genesis arc, in which Sonic and Sally are trapped in an alternate reality where they are meeting for the first time. Yet the twist is that their feelings for each other from the previous world remain. And I love how the comic uses this to depict their attraction to one another in ways we don't often get to see. Like that feeling of, dang, she kinda cute though. The first thing Sonic says upon seeing Sally is, "Oh, wow." And I love how simple that is. This story revels in allowing Sonic and Sally to enjoy the little moments with each other, and it's so cute. They are flirting constantly, and it's so refreshing to see them be stripped of their responsibilities and worries and just be. All of this leads to a scene that warms my heart to no end. As I mentioned earlier, Sonic and Sally had a bad breakup. Sonic's supposed death and 1 year later return messed Sally up, causing her to demand Sonic choose between risking his life to save the world or settling down with her. Of course, Sonic can't do this for multiple reasons, and Sally doesn't take this well. While Sally spends issue after issue trying to rebuild her relationship with Sonic, and while he's aware that Sally's actions stemmed from a bunch of pressure and trauma, she holds this moment against herself for pretty much the rest of the comic, even after she and Sonic get back together. She's afraid to be romantically vulnerable again, afraid she'll mess things up on their first serious date. Meanwhile, Sonic wants nothing more than for Sally to have a good time, to shield her from all the problems going on, for the night to go perfect. Obviously, both are trying to tailor things for the other, and are therefore told to just be themselves. And what I love is how vulnerable this allows their date to be. They openly talk about their past relationships to see who was the most jealous. They're still one-upping each other. And at the end, Sally jokingly pushes Sonic when he wins the Battle of Wills. And I love how you can actually see him fidget a little when he thinks maybe he's messed up, and yet he continues his one-liner about how he's always one step ahead of everyone. Well, don't get too much further ahead. No? Why not? Because I want to be there by your side. Really? Think you can keep up? If you let me? Yeah, I guess I can slow down for you. Sonic and Sally really don't seem like they'd work as a couple. Like Sally says, there's no telling Sonic the Hedgehog to slow down, which is what makes it all the more special that he wants to. He chooses to. Sure, they could both just do their own thing, but where would the fun be in that? Sonic and Sally love each other, and that's what makes them more than willing to speed up or slow down so they can run side by side. At the start of the Genesis arc that I mentioned earlier, Sally is shot down by Eggman. Thanks to him resetting reality, however, Sonic and Sally are able to find each other in this new timeline. And throughout the entire story, something draws them together. But it's not just that they also happen to like each other in this reality. It's that being with each other feels correct. It feels right. And it's that connection that persists through Sonic's time there that allows him to recall his memories of the other world. At first, it's just a feeling that Sally will be hurt if he doesn't do something now. And that leads him to confront Eggman and attempt to fix the timeline, to maybe give him a few more seconds to save her. In one of my favorite moments in this entire franchise, as the world and the comic itself begins to fade away around her, with even Sonic unsure if things will work out, Sally isn't afraid. Sonic will take care of everything, as the two reach out and promise to meet again on the other side. When the world returns, Sonic saves Sally, and on their way to face the big man himself, Sally sees a message in the window. Their connection was so strong that even when all of time and space had shifted, their love for each other somehow pierced through it all. Absolutely beautiful. But of course, the good vibes can't last, because you can't keep the good doctor down. Resetting all of reality was just the opening act of Dr. Eggman's return, and shooting down Sally with zero hesitation was just a sneak peek of his new, twisted perspective on life, and all the ways to end it. Having reasoned his way out of insanity, the mad scientist coped in the one way he knew how, ego and science. Realizing that the only way a genius like him could be beaten over and over by one blue rat is because Sonic is the X factor in every experiment. He's luck. He's chance. He's pure chaos. And so, if Sonic is going to be a constant thorn in his side, why spend time worrying about him and focus on removing the variables he can control in and outside the comfort of his flying fortress, the Death Egg, high above the rodents that scurry below. Extra defenses to stop Nicole's hacking in her tracks, focused cannon fire on keeping Sonic's backup busy, a ring barrier to fend off against magic users, a mech designed to fight specific magic users who can manipulate technology, a remote EMP carrier to disable defenses disguised as a doll, a Silver Sonic and a Metal Sonic to keep their organic counterpart busy, a giant freaking Mecha Sonic for chaos and destruction, and the Egg Annihilator Beam for wiping cities off the map. And all of this? These were all just Plan Bs, The real main event is the World Roboticizer, designed to turn every living creature into robotic slaves. See, when Eggman reset reality, his goal was to create a world where every single being would be susceptible to roboticization, after he had found the populace had become immune, along with creating a world where, just maybe, the scales would be tipped in his favor, and Sonic's Chaos Factor would finally stay out of his way. Of course, that didn't happen, and Sonic was able to reset reality. But on the off chance that Sonic's world rewrite did in fact return the roboticization immunity, well, the World Roboticizer has a secondary use.
Do you recall, dear princess, what happens when you try to roboticize something that's already mechanical?
What's he talking about? When I tricked him into roboticizing my auto-automaton double. Oh no.
That's right, it explodes! All of Gunn's forces, all of the United Federation, blown back to the Stone Age! And let's not forget New Mobotropolis. There goes your precious Nanite City.
Dad, Bunny, and Nicole. Okay, I take back the laughing. Wait, you'll destroy every chapter of your Dark Egg Legion.
What's your point? I'll have millions of robot slaves to rebuild my robot army. Besides, you can't make an omelet without breaking a few Dark Egg Legionnaires.
That's right. Eggman is going to use what was a defect in robotization to effectively nuke every advanced civilization on Mobius, including our hero's home, which is entirely composed of microscopic machines.
So now it's go, go, go time, because you can't just smash the Death Egg with 8 hits. We are screwed. Sonic is pinned and all Sally can do is plug in Nicole and hope for something, anything that can stop this machine.
Nicole warns that no matter what, the Death Egg is going to fire. The only thing she might be able to do is control where it fires, saying that she can invert the beam to their location. But in the process, Sally won't be safe from its effects as she is currently inside the roboticizer. But of course, without hesitation, she takes it, realizing that with the second chance Sonic gave her, she can use that to save the entire world. And so she does, but at the cost of giving Eggman his greatest weapon, free rein to operate on the hearts of the Freedom Fighters.
Sonic to team, I'm tied up with Sally. Somebody stop Metal Sonic from getting to the cruiser.
Metal Sonic got snagged on a Freedom Fighter.
Really? Send the command. Detonate! But detonate!
A desire to break Sonic the Hedgehog, to where the doctor doesn't even have to kill him, if the rat can't even bring himself to run in the first place. One down.
Oh, walkers, no. What happened? Did he... Antoine? Twan? Twan?
You'll join him soon.
I got one of them? I finally got one?
Hang in there, buddy.
Don't you worry. I'm the fastest thing alive. I'll get you help. You'll be fine. You'll see. You'll be fine. She's gone. Bunny, she blames herself for Antoine and left for... somewhere. Three down. I need to get back to make sure my friends and family are all okay. If anyone isn't okay, then you'd better hope you can run faster than me.
Sonic isn't taking things so well.
I've described Archie Sonic as one that lives in the moment, and the way Sonic acts post Mecha Sally is like he's trapped in one long moment of anger and panic. The first thing he says upon hearing Eggman's plan is that he never should have shown him a shred of mercy, commenting how he can rot in a prison cell. Sonic has to be talked down by his friends as he tells them over and over that he can still save the day. He can still run. He then starts fighting with Knuckles over borrowing a warp ring so he can jump right over to saving Sally. But when told with all the logistical issues with that idea, Sonic then uses Knuckles' goal of finding his lost grandfathers against him. How if using the warp ring was to find something he cared about, he'd be all for it. Which is messed up for a few reasons, like Knuckles being an old friend of Sally's, the consistently dwindling numbers of Knuckles' people, and the sad fact that this topic was one they had a moment together before about. When Sonic storms off, Charmy sheepishly asks, "Is Sonic not our friend anymore?" Then there's the death threat. And make no mistake, this is a death threat. Unless you think that when Sonic says he wants to rough up the Babylon Rogues enough that they can't escape a free-falling building hurtling towards the ground, that he thinks they'll just get some bumps and bruises. I want to focus on this line. You birds are lucky I'm the good guy. which has the obvious connotation of, I really wish I wasn't right now. You know, especially since he goes on to lay out exactly what he'd do to them if he, wasn't the good guy. And what they could possibly do to make sure he didn't have to be. Heck, the fact that he says he's specifically the good guy really frames it as if it's a role he's internalized. So much of Sonic's identity is the image. Sonic is the hero of Mobius. He's met his evil counterpart and stood firm that his ways are superior and cooler than that. Which none of is to say that Sonic isn't good, but to show the interesting nuances of how Sonic sees that about himself. Either way, this moment is dark. Those little moments of viciousness we've seen throughout the story are coming to the forefront and starting to remind me of someone. He's always been aggressive, he's always been arrogant, but Sonic has too many people he loves to let that kind of thing ever consume him. Yet, as they're stripped away from him, as he realizes the value of protecting what he has left, Sonic becomes far more quick to anger, to violence, culminating in this scene.
What the?
Silver? Oh, Sonic, I'm looking for the traitor. Can you tell me where? Oh, for the love of, look, I really don't have the patience for this today. Go sell your brand of crazy elsewhere. No, listen, I know I jumped to conclusions before, but this time I'm sure of it. I even staked my, closing the window now. It's Antoine. Antoine will betray you all. Ah, you jerk, I'm trying to help. I've gotta stop. She's gone. What, who? Bunny, she blames herself for Antoine and left for somewhere. Oh, maybe she's the one then, since she's gone missing. Listen, there is no traitor. I believe in my friends. I believe you're a flake. Each of them is 100 times the hero you want to be. Now get out. Go home. But I can't. I'm stranded here. Then get out of my sight. Bunny's gone, Aunt. So is Sally. The whole city is turning against Nicole, and I don't know what to do about it. I can't even do anything to help you. Silver managed to predict one thing. The Freedom Fighters are done. Back when they first met, Sonic was quick to dismiss Scourge's rantings. But now, at his lowest moment, those same words of comparison resurface in his mind. And his response? A blank stare. While I don't think Sonic thinks he'll become evil like Scourge, I do think he's feeling those words in a way he can't describe, wondering if there's any truth in them. After all, when Amy and Tails come to find him, saying how things have fallen apart, Sonic doesn't even look at them. Falling apart? Dude, the Doc beat us. Nagus is king. The Freedom Fighters are done. So, but just like his friends have done for him before, and in the same way Sonic has done for Sally, they won't have it. Cutting his spiral off and demanding he get up. The Freedom Fighters are done? Nonsense. They didn't learn to be Freedom Fighters from just anyone. I love how the art depicts Sonic throughout this whole scene. He's down in the basement of Freedom HQ, right back to where he started the series. Underground, hiding from Robotnik and the world. But where the Sonic of old couldn't be contained, our Sonic is tired and hurt. The light in his eyes is blocked, glazed over. And we get to watch him slowly stand as his outstretched arms go from the couch to his friends, telling them that they're right and how he's not gonna let it get to him like it has slowly tried to. And as he's done before, Sonic puts a positive spin to how he feels in order to push forward and encourage his youngest friends, with this look of admiration and gratitude on his face. It's a scene I love so much, showing the next generation of Freedom Fighters pushing forward their hero, and my favorite example of why Archie Sonic's vulnerability, and the often negative ways it manifests, makes him so compelling. The Sonic who has needed that aggression to ground him in what's real, and let his friends help him like they always do. Team Fighters is formed, ready to travel the world and fight Eggman abroad, as Team Freedom protects the home front. And what I love is while at first it seems like Sonic is back to his old self, the moment he sees Mecha Sally, that lighthearted feeling fades, only for him to pull himself back and fight her for real, something he constantly hesitated to do before. He even has a one-liner to poke fun at Sally and everything. Even if she's a robot, he needs to brag about which one of them wore it better. Sonic isn't just back, he's been refined and has actually mellowed out quite a ton. Going forward, Sonic's general vibe is different. He's far more reserved with his quipping, the way he carries himself is more confident than cocky. He starts making calculated decisions as a leader instead of getting caught up in the moment, even making a point to stop himself to do so. And overall, he's just far more consistently reflective and focused on getting the job done. In fact, we actually get what I'd consider to be Sonic's first heroic speech that doesn't feel intended to hype up himself as a bonus, just the desire to stand up for what's right. Even his body language with how he confronts Eggman is different. I genuinely feel proud of him. And while that simmering anger is still there when it comes to protecting his friends, by the end of the comic, we have what feels like a world-weary, yet more mature Sonic. The final form of a Sonic who has to live in this horrible world, yet continues to push forward to see things to the end. Which, speaking of that end, if you know anything about Archie Sonic, then you know it doesn't exactly have an ending. Due to a lawsuit, the comic met an untimely and abrupt conclusion, as Dr. Eggman rewrites reality once more, and this time for keeps, creating a new world for Sonic and his friends to live in, cutting short every single character thread and plotline. We never save Sally, Antoine, Bunny, nothing gets resolved, and Sonic's journey just stops. And yet, I'm not really bothered by this. If the comic had ended earlier, if the end result of Sonic's personality was bitterness and anger, this would hurt. All I'd have left is the decay of such a charismatic, interesting, and lovable character. But instead, I have this. As Amy looks around, overwhelmed by the senseless destruction Eggman has continued to leave behind, despite their best efforts, Sonic pulls Amy in for a hug and holds her. You can actually track Sonic's entire character growth by how he reacts to being hugged by Amy, all leading to this moment. As Sonic provides her with a potential solution for their problems and a guiding principle that regardless of what happens, they just have to keep moving forward, like they've always done, together. So, with all that being said, let's answer the question. Why is Archie Sonic so good? Because he's just way past cool.